So I am Shishpa, and I'm part of the core team of Jito Mentorship Program. This Level Up series is being conducted by the mentors of Jito Mentorship Program. Jito Mentorship Program, as a lot of you already know, is one of the several initiatives of Jito Professional Forum. It is a pro bono initiative open to all members of the Jain community. I would now like to invite Mr. Prashant Jain, Vice Chairperson of Jito Professional Forum and Managing Director of GE Power, to give us an introduction of the Jito and JPF. Over to you, Prashant Ji.
Jai Janendra, everyone. Very good morning to you all and welcome to this call. For those who are new and have joined for the first time, I think it's important to know Jito as an organization. So while you see the slide coming up, Jito is a unique NGO. It has got a place in its Limca Book of World Records for a very large corpus and its contribution to the community. It has about 800 crore balance sheet, corpus of 300 crore plus, 15,000 members roughly now, and 11 countries, 45 chapters, 55 plus chapters now, and several projects and initiatives. The three core areas that Jito is involved with, engaged with, is education, empowerment, and seva. And when we say empowerment, this is about business network. It is about connecting the business network, empowering Jain community, fellow brethren and sisters to develop personally and professionally in their entrepreneur and empower themselves economically. The second area is the education. There's a lot that's happening there with Jito Excellence Center for Excellence. There's with Jito Administrative Training Foundation, where there are programs for IAS officers, etc. And the third element is seva, where there is Shraman Aragyam and several programs in contribution to the society. So those are the three broad areas in which Jito is engaged in. Coming to Jito Professional Forum, which is the host of today's program, over the decade, Jito was driven by largely an entrepreneur or trader community. That is why Jito International Trade Organization, it was largely a trading community. The demographics of Jain community is evolving, and we see more and more Jains becoming global accomplished corporate professionals. And therefore, there was this need that was felt roughly 3-4 years ago, and Jito Professional Forum was formed to connect global accomplished professionals with aspiring young professionals and create that professional community. As a part of this program, the flagship program is Jito Mentorship Program. And we will share with you some details, as Sanyog Ji will share those details coming later in the program, on how you can become a part of this program and create benefits. So we have roughly about 3,000 JPF invitees. The programs are in two areas: Jito Corporate Professionals, so professional program for corporate salaried professionals. On the other side, practicing professionals like lawyers, chartered accountants, architects, doctors. And there's some phenomenal work happening there in connecting these global professionals. For example, with the doctors, there is a global doctor repository to enable medical tourism, second consulting, connecting R&D topics, how do you develop ethical practicing of medical professionals, so on and so forth. So a lot happening in this platform. It's great for the community and by the community. All the Jito members are contributing significant amount, time and effort to give back to the community. And that is what excites me, inspires me to be here. And that is the forum. Back to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Shanji. And now really, without any delay, can we just get into this whole topic, which is what we are all here for, that is spiritual intelligence in the professional context. So Sanyog, would you like to take us through what is the flow and how are we going to go about today?
Yes, I would, Sushmaji, and thank you. Before we begin, I would like to inform the audience that our session today with our guest will start as a panel discussion. It will be followed by a small introduction of Jito Mentorship Program, post which we will have question and answer with the panel. You can post your questions in the chat box while the session is going on. Our formal program will end by 12:30 p.m. The panelists and the team members will stay to answer any additional questions that the audience may have. Let me formally and quickly introduce our guest, and this is in an alphabetical order. First, Mr. Amit Jain. Amit Ji is a COO and business leader at Oyo India PropCo. He describes himself as someone who loves to introspect and constantly declutter his mind, workspace, etc. He values learning and becoming a better version of himself. He's learning to admit mistakes and expressing gratitude, accept diversity in views and preferences, and stay serene. He has a privilege to be part of a joint family. His two kids are writing their board exams this year. Amitji, we know how it feels for parents. Welcome, Amitji.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanyogji. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for making me a part of this August gathering and panel.
You're welcome, Amitji. Our next guest is Mr. Prashant Jain. Prashantji is a managing director of GE Power. He's passionate about applying ancient wisdom in modern context for professional and personal success. He's actively involved with Arham Dhyan Yoga and Jainan organizations of like-minded people for practical application of Jain principles for professional growth. He is vice chairman of Jito and president of Delhi National Capital Region, Hummat Samaj. Welcome, Prashantji.
Hey, Jinendra, everyone. Pleasure to be a part of this.
Our next guest is Mr. Vishal Jain. Vishalji is MD of Accenture. He is highly qualified. I will not embarrass him by listing all his degrees and qualifications. Vishalji has been practicing meditation for 12 years and has practiced various forms of meditation, including Shiv Yoga, Brahma Kumari, Art of Living, and Kriya Yoga. Vishalji believes in the need for strong spiritual foundation for professional and personal growth. He is the convener of the JPF mentoring program, and the aim of this program, of this initiative, is to give wings to the dreams of the next generation. Welcome, Vishalji.
Thank you so much, and Jai Jinendh, everyone.
Jai Jinendh. Moderating the session today will be Sushma Bantia, co-team member of JPF mentoring team. Sushma ji is a leadership coach, facilitator, EI practitioner, and author. She has been training and mentoring people on their leadership capabilities internationally. During her corporate career, Sushma ji held the position of VP engineering in a pacemaker company in US. She routinely moderates Level Up Series programs. She has a master's in computer science from University of Pittsburgh and is based in Bangalore.
Welcome. Thank you. Sushmaji. Thank you so much. It's such an honor and a pleasure to be here.
And with
and
that,
to be associated with Jito.
Right? With that, over to you, Sushmaji.
Thank you.
From here.
Thank you so much. And I'm really been looking forward to this particular Level Up series, because I'm so curious to know about spiritual intelligence. Growing up, it was like religion, jake, you'd go to the temple, do the puja. And then here we have spiritual intelligence in the professional context. So there's just so many doubts that come to my mind about it. And of course, there are certain things I resolved over time and I have my own views on that, but I would really love to hear the views and experiences of the esteemed panelists right here. And I'm sure that's exactly how a lot of us would benefit from. So the other thing that got me curious was, we are talking about spiritual intelligence today. And we say, yes, it's an important topic. And when I go to the World Economic Forum and say, what are the qualities needed in the leader of tomorrow? Spiritual intelligence isn't even listed in the top 10. Emotional intelligence is there. Creativity is there. Collaboration is there. Innovation is there, and some others. But spiritual intelligence doesn't figure. So I'm curious to know from each one of you, what does spiritual intelligence really mean to you? And what is your take on it? So could we start with Amitji, please, going alphabetically for the first round?
Sure, sure. Absolutely. Absolutely, Sushmaji. And, you know, this is a topic, you know, which is obviously very intriguing. And since I was called to speak on this topic, I have done a lot of reading and refreshment myself, right? And a lot of concepts, the flow of thoughts has become much clearer. And, you know, I should obviously thank Prashantji and Vishalji for kind of shortlisting me for this session. So, you know, spiritual intelligence looks very fancy and very complex to beginners, right? And you're very confusing also, right? But there's, so before I speak on spiritual intelligence, I would like to speak on a few basic principles, you know, which are very, very important, and we actually apply them in our daily lives. So one, we all know about choices, right? So, and we all know about wisdom. So these are the two things which I would first like to explain or discuss before even coming to spiritual intelligence. So, you know, whosoever we are, whether we are a student, whether we are a professional beginner, or whether we are a professional adult, or, you know, we are in our late stage of life, at every moment we are making choices, right? And these choices could be with respect to our words, thoughts, or actions, right? You know, in the words of Stephen Covey, you know, who most of us would know, you know, he has laid down a universal paradox of choice. He said, we are free to make our choices, but we are not free from the consequences of our choices, right? So therefore, it is so important to make the right choices or better choices. You know, I don't know what right choices are, but obviously, you know, we have to make better choices. So this is a principle which we all agree, which we all face in our daily lives, right? Even the choice to be present on this session, you know, is something, you know, which you have processed in your mind and you have told, oh, whether I should give my 90 minutes to the session or not. This is a choice which you're making, right? Now, how do you make better choices in life, right? That's where, you know, wisdom comes into play, right? Wisdom, you know, very simplistically speaking, what is wisdom, right? There is intelligence and there is wisdom, right? Agar main isko Hindi mein explain karun, to ye buddhiman hai, to wo intelligent hai. Agar ye samajhdar hai, to ye wise hai, right? And this is a very basic difference, and we have seen, you know, our elder generations who may not be very intelligent because they have not gone to formal schools, etc., but, you know, they are very wise. And, you know, wise and wisdom comes from a lot of sources. Now, there are a lot of emotions which we play with in our daily lives. And frankly, when we come to even professional issues, right, there is always a choice between need and greed. There is always a choice between courage and stupidity. There is always a choice between, you know, gain in apparent losses and losses in apparent gains, right? Now, how do you kind of sieve through all this, right? This is where wisdom helps you. Now, the next question is wisdom. What is wisdom, right? So wisdom is actually a combination of your knowledge, your experience, and your intuition, right? And it's very important to emphasize that, you know, none of this is only related to your mortal self, right? And frankly, we relate to all these aspects only to our mortal self, but a lot of this is also, you know, related to our soul, right? And this is where, you know, we should connect, you know, that this is all not just body knowledge and experience, but also a lot which is related to our soul, because our soul has transcended over multiple lifetimes, right? So there is a lot of knowledge, experience, which is stored in our soul, right? And it is actually the ultimate source of knowledge and experience. And to my mind, spiritual intelligence is nothing but unlocking, discovering, tapping the knowledge, experience, and intuition which we have within ourselves, right? But what happens is that whenever we are choosing or deciding, right, there is a soft inner voice which is probably guiding us in the right direction, but there are a lot of thoughts, emotions, which kind of cross our minds, and actually the noise of these thoughts is much louder than this inner voice, right? And, you know, this just gets overshadowed, and, you know, we actually get confused and we are not able to think clearly, so on and so forth. The emotions kaun se hote hain? You know, normally these emotions are greed, fear, ego, anger, so on and so forth, right? So spiritual intelligence actually helps us to put these emotions apart, tap on our inner knowledge, and kind of be able to take the right decisions or to make better choices, right? I would just like to end this thought with one you know, quote from Swami Vivekananda, which I actually had, you know, read very, very long time ago, you know, because where I live, there is Ramakrishna Ashram, you know, within 2 kilometers from my house. And as a child, I was just fascinated. I used to visit that ashram and, you know, just kind of search various books. And there were quotes which were, written on the walls, right? So one quote which I've always shared with me is that talk to yourself at least once in a day. Otherwise, you may miss meeting an exceptional person, right? And this yourself is nothing but your soul, right? And frankly, this is what we not do, right? Whenever we are seeking guidance from everyone else except ourselves, right?
True.
And this is where, spiritual intelligence comes into play. You know, you have to be inward looking. It does not mean being an introvert. Inward looking is actually being watchful and mindful of your thoughts, words, and actions. And you will see for yourself that a lot gets solved, simplified in life.
Sure. Thank you so much. You know, you so beautifully set the context in terms of not only what spirituality is, but, you know, why, in terms of okay, better decisions and even connecting it up with the soul and wisdom. Okay. So Prashantji, may I invite you? What is your take on spiritual intelligence?
I would pick on what you said in the beginning. Spiritual intelligence, in my view, is a journey. And this journey could begin with IQ, which is intelligence. It could begin from emotional intelligence. It could begin from your religious beliefs and backgrounds. It could begin from your personal values or ethos. But this is a journey, and the destination is possibly that happiness and peace that you find within. And whenever you lose track, probably meditation or reflection is what could help you to expand or come back into your comfort zone. So if I have to summarize my thoughts on spiritual intelligence is a journey, and the destination probably is peace, happiness, which is within. Now, if I go back to the professional context and for the people on this call, if they have to reflect their journey on spiritual intelligence, I will share my journey on spiritual intelligence. When I started my career 93-95, most of the entrance tests or, you know, job evaluation was done on aptitude. Mm. They were doing tests to check your analytical skills and your aptitude and your general knowledge. It was all knowledge-driven tests. When I came into middle management, I found programs that were introduced by the various leadership programs, which were covering emotional intelligence. And they said, you know, it is not about being knowledgeful. It is about connecting with people, inspiring people, and creating that inspiration around you so that you're successful. IQ may not be important, but EQ is more important to become a great leader. And to me, that was the middle point of my journey on spiritual intelligence. And probably if I look back now in the last 3 to 4 years, where I'm seeing now a lot of mindfulness being brought in by the leadership gurus. And they are talking about, is this candidate reflective? Is he mindful? Is he aware? Is he thinking in the right way? Does he have the right values? Can he be a great leader? So today in the organizations now, when I see we are selecting talent for senior leadership positions, from a functional manager to a leader, the big tollgate that we ask today is mindfulness. Is he thinking? Is he reflecting? If not, maybe he will not be a great leader. So that in the sense, if I have to then summarize again, spiritual intelligence is a journey. For me, it personally started with the strong foundation my parents gave by religion, thus Lakshan, 10 values. And that became my foundation. It got validated over the journey in my career. And I think it's an amazing journey. And maybe I will cover about meditation a bit later. When we come back again, but for now, I think my context is journey in the spiritual intelligence.
Thank you so much. And as you were speaking, you know, I was sort of visualizing the corporate environment. Okay, entry level, IQ, knowledge, you know, individual contributor. Now you're going to people management role. You need emotional intelligence. Now you're really in a leadership role, and spiritual intelligence becomes really the key. How you lead the company, the impact the company has on, you know, everyone around. And are we really making the better decisions, the right decisions, combining all that I'm sure Vishalji has lots to offer us on all this. And also, if you could bring out the distinction, Vishalji, on religion and spirituality. One of the questions that had come in the registration forms was Jainism as a religion versus spiritual intelligence. Sure. Over to you.
So a few things as Prashant and Amit covered. I think to me, spiritual intelligence is like going deeper and going inner, right? As Amit also mentioned, I was just reading today's newspaper, Times of India. So I'll just show that. So there is this article about how to stop selling yourself short and overcome self-doubt. So it says five things. Boost, break your negative thought. Number two, don't break the urge to compare yourself with others. Number three, have self-compassion. Number four, have gratitude. And number five, would you treat yourself the same way the way you treat others? Now, this is nothing new. We have been reading, we have been taught about it in all corporate trainings. However, trainings, just Sushma ji telling me today that have gratitude doesn't mean that
right.
I will change myself. Maybe I'll remember for a day. And if at all, Amit is saying, don't have ego. I get very supercharged. I don't want to compare myself. Don't have ego. But training doesn't really resolve that, right? These are deep qualities of the inner self. When we develop them, when we meet that inner person every day, then we deepen and then we work on it. Otherwise, it becomes very superficial. So the whatever I just talked about are the same thing what we talk in the professional context, that you, for you to be successful, you have to be compassionate, you have to be collaborative, you have to be resilient. More and more people are talking about you have to be courageous, you have to have a strong right decision making and clarity and awareness. But how is not a training curriculum? How is not about going for a management course in a fancy university for even if for 2 months, for a year? How is by working on it at a deeper level, at the core level, on an everyday basis, then one is able to make a difference, right? One thing I do want to also call out, that sometimes we feel, and even when I talk to my son, that this is like for your age. I'm a class 12 student. So maybe for me, what matters is this functional skill. And this is IQ and then EQ and all. I just want to correct that, having this awareness, having this understanding throughout life, even as a student, to a fresher, to a mid-management, will give one a competitive edge. And this is what I truly believe in. When I meet people in my company as a fresher, I can clearly make out people who are really genuinely true value-driven at the heart, mm-hmm. versus others who are not. And generally, without even saying that, there is more respect, more authenticity in the voice of someone who is more inner inclined compared to somebody who is not. And naturally, then that person gets more, let's say, respect for his or her views or more opportunities. It just comes naturally. So I do want to just call out that don't treat it as we often heard, jab time aayega, sab kuch kar liya, job kar li, growth kar li, and now is the time to look at spirituality. It is not like that. I think our context here, the session today, is about spiritual intelligence in the professional context. So for one to get the right job, for one to get growth, for one to be fulfilled, what one can do. And these are in the materialistic terms. Yes, there will be a peace of mind, there will be good relationship, but that anyway one would get by being inward. But beyond that, would I be successful if I follow these values? Would I be able to fetch the right opportunity if I follow this? The answer, my own reflection, truly, strongly is yes. I think the point, part two of your question was the difference. Certainly, I think the core purpose or the core values across religions are same. I think it's the end game is same. I think it's a religion is like a code of conduct. You may have a code of conduct or practices to get there. And you need to follow those practices and code of conduct. However, following one path versus other, all paths could very well be leading to the same destination, does not need to hold us back. What has happened eventually, gradually, is that because religions sometimes have led to divisions, people have scaled back to talk about it openly. I think the
true value, right? If whether Swami Vivekanand or Mahatma Gandhi or any guru or otherwise, the true values are all same. You have to be truthful, you have to have integrity, you have to be compassionate. These are all same. So I think spirituality is a very universal definition of some of the very core principles. That's the way I look at it.
Thank you. Absolutely. You know, something which you brought out, you know, and I had not reflected on so much before, but I think it's so beautiful that you brought it out, that somebody who has spiritual intelligence, when you interact with them, you will be able to make out. There'll be something in their body language, there will be something on their face, there will be something there that which you'll know that, yes, this person lives by values. And are values really respected today? And if we have that or not, what has been your personal experiences? You know, you've been leading corporations, you're right up there, you've achieved that success. Were you always spiritually inclined as you rose up the corporate ladder, or was there a time when it just came as, hey, you know, what am I doing and why am I doing this type of a realization? I'd love to hear from y'all. What were your personal experiences? If you could share some where you've used it in the corporate environment. So who'd like to take this on first? Prashantji, maybe?
I can share a couple of examples personally in my career where it did help to reflect or step back or to manage my own emotions. And I can give a failure first. There was an opportunity when I was supposed to be leading a business. And as I was deputed to that site to take over the position, and there was a manager who was supposed to come in as my reporting manager. He did not turn in. And then at that point, there was a vacancy available for the next position. So I was going there, say, for a position A, and this was position B, which suddenly became available. And then when position becomes available, politics start. So people came up and said, you know, Prashant, why don't you apply? We have a strong stance. We will support you. We'll make you get there. Why do we want anybody else to come in this place now? Take a double promotion. Mm. And I took a step back and I said, look, why am I doing this? Am I ready? What is my purpose? My purpose is to learn, develop myself, develop the business, and eventually, you know, find that balance. And I don't think I'm ready yet for the position. And we politely declined. And I said, no, I'm not ready for this position. I would not like to participate and I would not like to get into politics. That is not my nature. And I stepped back for a couple of years. And 3 years later, I think, God willing, I have followed one basic fundamental is learning is the one I will chase. If I'm learning and where I see my learnings have stopped, I move to the next position. And that has become my key guiding factor. It has taken me through stressful situations. And that is when meditation has helped me to relax, step back, and then again, you know, take the next move. So that was one example which I could share, that when we come out of comfort zone and when you want to stick to your personal values, can you really move forward? There were other examples for sure. Maybe Amit and Vishal, and then maybe I come back.
Sure. Thank you so much. I mean, okay. So somewhere I also see a trend here, and which, you know, I would like you all to answer, is meditation. Vishaldi does meditation. So for spiritual intelligence, is meditation really important? What is meditation? You know, you talked about, okay, you know, what is inner peace? So if you could share your own personal journey and example.
Sure. So maybe I can share. For me, yes, to your question, it did not become like all of a sudden, hey, I need to get this and this. This is not like another new technique. So maybe it gradually happened. It has been a 12 years journey as a part of meditation, as part of my daily life. I do about an hour at least every day. And I've seen that. And just to give you more on the personal side about by doing meditation, I really felt like I'm a finance person who looks at return on investment. I could clearly vouch from my own experience that there is a ROI every day basis, right? When I do, when I do not. Now, how would I judge that? I would judge that am I in control? Am I calm? Mm. How I come across with people, whether in the morning or right in the late in the night. because your energy dips, right? Am I dealing with the person senior level the same way as a most junior person, or am I differentiating, right? Or am I having clarity of thoughts, right? That's how. So not that, as Prashant mentioned, it's a journey. So not that, okay, we suddenly become like a saint, or so we all have our own burst of emotions as recent as yesterday. But I do believe that it really helps a lot, right? Mm-hmm. In my own journey, a lot of my ideas, you won't believe, some of the path-breaking ideas came out of some weird thoughts during meditation. Not that you have to crave for those ideas, but somewhere your mind is still, you are more aware, maybe you're able to connect the dots. And some of those ideas became, in my ex-company, American Express, some of the big ones. They ran for years and they became global platforms, right? It also gave me a calmness and clarity in decision making, courage to take a decision. Otherwise, when you have a hard decision to follow, which in the short term could be with a lot of hard work, but in the long run should be good, but you have to have clarity and conviction. How do you get that conviction when you're not attached to the outcome? And how you're not attached to the outcome is when you practice equanimity every day and you realize that ultimately everything is impermanent. So when you're really internally chatting about it every day, then you really are able to take those decisions. So they do not come like one day I meet with some mentors of mentorship program and I'll take a decision. Every day one will have to then work on that. Other part I would say is because I was doing meditation, I felt like I must do it regularly. Then I felt like while I'm doing it at home, why not I do it at Mandir? So I started going to Jain Mandir because of that. Then I felt like when I'm doing it over the weekdays, but not doing weekend, because generally weekend there was no office, so there was no Mandir in the way. So that triggered the thought, why not take a Niyam? So I took a Niyam 6 years back, which was 8th January 2016, about going to Mandir every day. And the intention was not that suddenly, hey, I must do Dev Darshan and all, I frankly admit, but it was more about that I wanted to bind myself to this toolkit of meditation. And by doing that every day, because it's been about 6 years, I did falter about 4 or 5 days. And there were days when I remember late in the night, 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock, but I actually stood out to do Darshan because I had to honor that commitment. But because of that, taking that Niyam, I could get a lot of willpower that, yes, if at all I have to do something, I'll take a formal Niyam before Mandir, before Bhagwanji, and I'll take a Niyam. Now that led to many such Niyams, whether it's about on the health side or whether on the personal side or so. Now by going to Mandir now, because I felt that why I'm doing this through car, why not I take cycle? Because it serves the purpose so that there's a less of unnecessary why to really have Jeevhatya, one side, right? Other side is that it's a very health-wise, very good. So now that has become a routine, right? Now, since that has become a routine and a Mandir nearby, near our place is Bashapur, is a big slum, so to say, very, very old area. And when I go there every day, I see there are cows, there are people without enough means. And that keeps me grounded that why should I trouble myself about this is happening or not happening? Because it's everyday grounding, right? Why, while we may be perturbed about our jobs and career growth, or I may be, right? But when I see people without food on an everyday basis, it keeps me grounded that, by the way, let's see things in perspective and count my blessing. Now in that process, the giving has become every day, that giving cows roti and otherwise somebody, the old lady giving roti from home, right? It has become every day. So what I'm telling you is a practical way, what was meditation led me to be more healthy because it became routine every day. I will do 25 minutes of cycling. It gave me that gratitude on a daily basis. It made me grounded, not to be in my ego that, hey, I'm a managing director, so who are you, right? And not to be, it made me humble as well, that not to be so much in the success that I'm this and who are you type, right? And gave me some ideas and thoughts during meditation. Now, this really helped me certainly in the professional journey for sure, because people could see, right? So what started as a one simple idea, just strong conviction about meditation led me to several such things. That's why I think there are many ways in this journey. Meditation is not the only one. But I do believe one thing what Amit said, that you have to meet the most important person in your life, which is you every day. whichever way you do that, you will uncover more of yourself. So that's what I would say, Sushmaji.
Absolutely amazing. Thank you. And thank you for sharing it. You know, your entire journey has been so, so amazing. You know, one small thing leading to the next, how everything is sort of linked, you know. And I think very often we don't reflect on these things and see it. And, you know, when somebody talks like this, it really takes me back tremendously. Yeah, jo bhi ho raha hai, kisi wajah se ho raha hai. So the environment right now around me is also feeling very spiritual because of all the sharing that is happening with you all. So Amitji, would you like to share your own experiences?
Yeah, you know, absolutely. See, and I think there are few practical experiences which I guess a lot of us go through in our professional lives. So, you know, so I actually started going to temple since, you know, I was in standard six. So, you know, I'm fortunate to be staying at the same place for the last 40 years. So, you know, I'm going to the same temple, you know, on a daily basis, except, you know, when I'm not in town or traveling. But, you know, then obviously you have your own to-dos, you know, which you could do, you know, even when you're not, you know, in front of the God physically. So, so the value system tha, religious belief tha, you know, I used to hear about meditation, but I actually never understood what meditation is, right? And frankly, you are reading the right stuff. So for example, the quote of Swami Vivekananda, which I mentioned. So, you know, you were aware of this, but frankly, you know, you never felt the weight behind this quote or the real purpose behind this quote, you know, until and unless you were really faced with a lot of adversity, right? So I had, you know, two adverse situations, you know, which actually, you know, really changed me, you know, as a person, you know, I would say. You know, one, you know, I lost my father in 2001, right? And that was the same year I had got married. And the company I was working with, they wanted me to, you know, come to Bombay, you know, and for financial professionals, you know, Bombay is the place to be. You know, I was posed with this serious dilemma that, you know, yes, there is a career which is waiting for me in Bombay. And, you know, then I have some, you know, responsibilities towards my family. You know, I have a younger brother who was not married at point in time. You know, I couldn't probably have left my family in just, you know, sacrificing all the personal pursuits just for materialistic pursuits, right? So I did not know, you know, what was right, what was wrong. But obviously, you know, I just wanted, you know, more holistic approach to this whole decision making, right? Which effectively meant that, you know, job at the end of the day or career at the end of the day is more a means of livelihood, right? And, you know, you cannot compromise, you know, your other responsibilities, duties, just in pursuit of one direction, right? So I am actually very, very happy, you know, that I took that decision. You know, I had the foresight to say or see that, you know, I'll have family soon, right? How will I tap into my mother's experience, you know, in bringing up my kids? You know, how would I have that support system? How would I be helpful to her? So on and so forth, right? My mother had a, you know, a heart bypass, you know, a heart issue in 2016. You know, I was by her side. You know, had I been not in India or not in Delhi, probably I could have not attended to that situation, you know, on such an urgent basis, right? So frankly, in hindsight, you know, I am very happy that I took that decision, which was kind of, you know, in interest of everybody else, you know, and not just me, right? So that was one event which actually changed my life. But I still did not know that was that spiritual intelligence, was that coming from spirituality, so on and so forth. But, you know, obviously, one was going to the temple on a daily basis, you know, had the right set of values and ethics, so on and so forth, right? The second situation which came in my life was, you know, when I actually, you know, was tested. And, you know, the point which Prashantji was making that, you know, you were always academically a topper, right? You went to the best colleges, you know, then you kind of scored ranks in your professional exams also. And then you get the job, which is probably a dream job for everyone else, right? So, you know, all is going hunky-dory for you. And, you know, you are very happy in your zone, ki yaar hum to bond hai, right? And frankly, you know, we could probably succeed in whatever we do. So I made a career choice in 2007, where I actually moved from an institutional setup, to a much, much smaller setup, right? And frankly, this was not a change I was ready for. And it's only when I made this change and I actually was kind of going through the grind on a daily basis that I realized. And, you know, I used to view myself, probably I have done a, big time career mistake. It's a disaster. I should go back to wherever I've come from, and this is not the path I should be treading.
Mm.
Right. And I was, I can't tell you, Sushmaji, I was actually on the verge of depression, right? I would not shave for days. I would go to the office in the same manner. I was feeling completely dejected about myself that, I have probably done the worst thing I could have done to myself. And see, all the other people, who are there with the organization still, they are doing so well, etc. So then, and this the intelligence which you draw on, I can tell you, it just strikes you. Obviously, you can practice it through various means, but, it just strikes you. And that's the time when that Swami Vivekananda quote started helping me, right? So this sense of entitlement, yaar, hum toh ye hain, humare saath aisa hi hona chahiye, humare saath hi kyun kharab ho raha hai, these are the kind of thoughts which one has to fight on a daily basis, right? You are not entitled, right? If you feel either in personal or professional life that you are entitled, then I think that's the biggest mistake which you are making, right? And you have to kind of prove yourself at each and every step, whether in the corporate life or whether in personal life, right? And that's the time when I started, looking deeper into myself, and I started asking myself, maybe I have made a bad choice, but still there is a brighter side to it. There are a few things which I'm still learning, I'm enjoying in this job, right? And why don't I focus on, what I'm learning and how I'm differentiating myself from my other ex-colleagues, right? That's the time, when I started comparing myself with what, others have or how others are doing. And I just started focusing on what I am doing and what I want to be. And therefore, and that's the time when I started recognizing that, learning has to be constant. You have to be a constant learner, and learning is not just about books, Excels, PowerPoints, etc. Learning is much more beyond. And something again, which I kind of, grasped from that experience, was that all of us are, endowed with 24 hours in a day, right? All of us need time, for sleep, for recreation, etc., right? Then how is someone different, so much different from the other person, right? It's just the kind of utilization of time which makes us so different, right? How are we, and that's where the choice comes from. How I choose to spend my 12, 14, 16 hours a day, right? That's what decides who I am. So frankly, in hindsight, both those events, I feel I actually drew upon my spiritual intelligence or spiritual quotient, to kind of progress in life. And did ethics help? Did religion help? Did values help? Of course, right? Because even in those most adverse and negative situations, whatever positivity I was getting was actually getting through, going to the temple daily, and just, when you're talking to God, right? Mm. It's an out of world experience, right? And that talking is actually not talking to the God, that talking is actually to your own self. So that has been my learnings. Mm. And, the way, I have experienced intelligence, and as Vishal, Prashantji, myself, or anybody on this call, right, whose life is perfect at the end of the day, right? Nobody's, right? When you stop seeking perfection in life, or perfection as an output, but you start building perfection as an input, is when you feel that the person is now getting spiritually intelligent. That's how I feel it.
Thank you so much, and I want to especially thank you for being so vulnerable and sharing so openly your entire journey of, what happened and, almost near depression and, everything. I mean, just, it requires a lot of courage, and I'm sure it requires a lot of spiritual intelligence right there to be able to share with such a large forum and openly about what all you went through. So that should, this will be a good learning for all of us, ki haan ye ho sakta hai, but eventually we can, each one of us, come out of it if we look internally. The best person you will meet is yourself. Mm-hmm. It's not about what other person is doing or wo kya kar raha hai, ye kya kar raha hai, hum kya kar rahe hain. Eventually, I mean, that is to me a huge takeaway right now itself. I am very mindful of time, and I know I can just go on and on and on, and you know, I can go on for 3 days, 4 days, because it's just so much learning. I'm so excited about it. But being mindful of time, I just remind everyone that we'll have one more one question towards Prashantji, after which we'll invite Sayog to just give a little bit about the mentorship program, and then it's open to, I'm sure all the participants here have lots they want to learn from all of you and share. Some are already sharing in the chat box. We'll go into the participants, we'll open it up for questions from them, formally close the program at 12:30, and then continue discussions for a little more time, right? So Prashantji, you were really talking about building muscle and spiritual intelligence muscles. So we'd love to hear your own experience and how we can do it. And so all this, you know, when we're looking at it, huh, corporate environment may, and how do we start? Is it only at the top levels or even other levels? And how do people start? What is your message to the younger generation today?
Thank you. I would say that a lot of times we look at the world from what we know, and that limits our potential and our growth. You know, when you are working for a manager, you think your manager is end of the world. And you create your world with those limitations. Arey yaar, mera manager usko promotion deta hai, mujhe nahi deta hai. And your world is so small, because when you start your career, you don't have that visibility of a larger perspective. You don't see the world as a different world, which is interdependent, that everybody is interdependent on one another. So that perspective or that mindset is, in my view, the trigger for development into spiritual intelligence. Mm-hmm. Now, how do you develop that mindset? I will give two thoughts that I have experienced personally. First thought, and this thought will help you get rid of politics. This thought will help you look at a larger picture for yourself and for the society. So the first tool that I want to give you is win, win, win. Whatever you do, apply that filter of win, win, win. Is it a win for me? Is it a win for my company, my business? Is it a win for the society? The moment you start thinking like this, is it a win for me? Is it a win for the business? Is it a win for the society? If you are able to answer these three questions as yes, then this is the right thing to do. You should do it. If you think any of the answer is not coming straightforward, talk to the manager, clarify. Sir, I have this personal criteria, win, win, win. I think this is fitting to not the third. Please explain to me. And trust me, all managers, leaders, they will want the right thing for the organization. And all the organizations, all the investors today are having a very high amount of emphasis on sustainability, on the right mindset for leadership. And especially all the corporates, this is absolutely something that you can take for granted will happen. The second sutra I wanted to share, if you are a leader or a manager, again, there are three things I have always coached to my managers and my leaders. And I said, this is the sutra to kill politics and cut politics. Number one, every manager leader should align with the values and the vision of the organization. You should know the values and the vision of the organization. This is number one. Number two, all decisions have to be data-driven, analytical, and objective. All decisions have to be analytical, data-driven, and objective. And number three, invest in your own learning and development of your team members. If any of the manager who's a manager, if he follows these three sutras and he's communicating this to everybody around the team member, he creates positivity, he creates objectivity, and politics automatically starts dying down. If there is a mindset gap, I don't know why he's doing what he's doing, I will tend to create politics. The moment I start openly communicating with these two levers, is it win, win, win? or is it with the second three levels of leadership criteria? I think it clarifies a lot for the whole organization and it kills politics. So this was my experience, my journey, practically applied it in several contexts in my organization. I wanted to share with you all.
So thank you so much. Absolutely. You know, the two things that come up, okay? Ek to what Amitji said, you know, we all have 24 hours. Now, where do we want to spend that time? How do we want to utilize it? If we want to utilize it in politics, it's our choice. If we don't want to utilize it in politics, it's again our choice. And that spirituality will help us to have that mental peace, happiness, you know, feeling positive. Everything would depend upon the choices we make. And the other thing is, when you're talking about values, you know, just recently I had an opportunity where I was, the value of that organization, the way they had stated their mission statement, did not gel with me. And now I know I don't want to work with that organization. I got my answer right here. Thank you so much. A quick 1 minute, 2 minute from Vishalji. How would you like to see spiritual intelligence going forward towards our kids, the next generation, and for us in future?
Yeah, so I'll keep it brief. I think one thing is we should talk more about, in the professional context, the spiritual. What has happened is that dharm is equal to sometime in the morning. Mm-hmm. I've done my tick. Now that part is over. Now let me come to the real world where I want to make money. I want to grow. I want to grow my business. I think we have really alienated the two, mm-hmm. right? Because we feel like following these values will become hard in the practical context. I will be seen as timid, or probably I cannot make money by while following values. Maybe some of those things have come in, which is not the case. When you look at, even there are in the chats, some of the questions are there about some of the leaders like Jeff Bezos, Steve Jobs and all. Yes, we can look at those examples, how people are successful and how they did that. And what do we define as success? Success has to be holistic, where it is a professional plus personal, family, health, everything. So one thing, coming back to your question, is for us to really lead this, we have to talk more openly, even to a student, that for you not to be so disturbed in the exam. My son is going through in class 12th board. Now, you know it very well that if you too focus around kya score aayenge, right? Kya score aayega, aayega nahi aayega, so you will get so stressed out despite all your preparation. But if you are just focusing on perfection being input, or you're doing your best, what you can do, and you leave the rest, or as we say that, karm karo phal ki chinta mat karo. As you do that, we do know that a student will get better marks, Virat Kohli will get better scores if he's focusing on the work, not the outcome, correct? So I think we have to talk about it more in the real context, not to leave it to the spiritual elevation, moksha, that will be there. Naturally, 100%, if it all you're in that part. But in the realistic day-to-day life, how can I drive professional success, right decision-making, lead the team, inspire the team by following the principle? More we talk about it, it becomes clearer to people. And the good thing, I would just leave you with the one final point, is that in the last year and a half, more and more organizations are talking about mental well-being, mindfulness, mm-hmm. meditation. 3-4 years was not talked about. It was seen as like, do you have a problem if you're going for meditation retreat? I went for a meditation retreat, Vipassana, 10 years back. I did not disclose to everyone, right? Otherwise, people may feel that there's some problem happening in their personal life. Why would you go for 10 days retreat? But today, people do talk about it, right? Because people have realized, corporations have realized that this is very critical. Mental well-being is very, very critical. So that's a good thing that people are realizing. And I think we should talk more about it in the professional and the business context.
Sure, absolutely. So in the business context, start spreading the word maybe. And as leaders, what is it that we can do? Amitji, quick 2 minute from you, or 1 minute.
Sure. I think I'll just give you two concepts, Sushmaji. You know, one is, you know, Vishal and I both are chartered accountants. So, you know, CA, right? So commercial acumen. So I define CA as commercial acumen, right? Most of us, even from this community, are born with commercial acumen. So kahan fayda hai, kahan nuksaan hai, hume bahut achche se samajh mein aa jata hai. Padhane ki bhi nahi zarurat hoti, because we are trained to figure out, you know, profit or loss. But you know, there is MA as well, which is moral acumen, which is what is right or wrong, right? And frankly, you know, that's where decision making goes wrong, because we are just focused on CA and not on MA. And whenever you meet people, and that's the culture which you need to imbibe in your organization, ki yaar, theek hai, fayda toh ho raha, but ye sahi hai kya? You know, and if the answer is no, then the fayda does not make much sense for the organization. And I'll just kind of, you know, quote Warren Buffett here. So Warren Buffett was asked, you know, what do you look in a person to hire him? He said, I only look for three qualities: integrity, intelligence, and energy. And if he does not have the first, I do not care about the other two, right? So you have to understand the value of integrity or moral acumen, right, is more than anything else. And the more you kind of rise in your corporate life, and even in the earlier years of your life when you're doing stuff, you know, your progress may be a little slowed down, but frankly, I can tell you in the long run you would be the winner, because frankly, doing the right thing is very, very important, and you also have to be perceived to be doing the right thing, right? तो आपको मालूम है कि मैं सही कर रहा हूँ, वो जरूरी नहीं, उससे ज्यादा जरूरी ये भी है कि आपकी perception ऐसी हो कि आप सही काम कर रहे हैं. और ये तभी होता है जब you get into situations, जैसे इन्वेस्टमेंट बिजनेस में बहुत सी सिचुएशंस होती हैं, लोग आपसे कहते हैं आप इन्वेस्ट कर दीजिए, वी विल टेक केयर ऑफ यू. बाय व्हाट डू यू मीन बाय टेक केयर ऑफ यू? आई डू नॉट वांट टू गेट इनटू एनी सच थिंग. इफ देयर इज अ मेरिट वी विल इन्वेस्ट, इफ देयर इज नो मेरिट वी विल नॉट इन्वेस्ट, राइट? सो आई थिंक यू हैव टू बिल्ड योर इमेज, योर कैरेक्टर लाइक दैट पीपल एक्चुअली सी यू एज अ नो नॉनसेंस पर्सन व्हेन इट कम्स टू एथिक्स और मॉरल वैल्यूज.
थैंक यू सो मच. And we will continue this discussion just in a few minutes. Give everybody time to think about it and write in the chat box if you have any questions which you'd like to ask the panelists. And Sayok, over to you to just tell us about the mentoring program that Jito runs.
Thank you, Sushma ji. I would say the discussion so far has been beautiful, mesmerizing, and uplifting. If we had an instrument to measure, we would be able to see the difference in 88 houses where the voices of our mentors are going. But you can also see it in the chat box where people are asking, how can I get mentorship from our panel? So that is what Jito Mentorship Program is all about. And listening to our speakers, our panelists, our guests, I think, you know, the reason why we are doing what we are doing gets reinforced even further. So let me just share with you a few things about what is happening as far as the mentorship program is concerned. Yeah, there are numbers, and the numbers are beginning to look good. So far we have, 37 mentors who have been onboarded. And the second round of empanelment has already begun. And the goal of this particular program is to have 100 mentors. And I know that we will hit that number very fast because the need is so great. So far, 125 sessions have been conducted, and we have got great reviews on the sessions that have been done. We have received 309 JOT forms. Those are the forms that people complete in order to ask for mentorship. So for the last 4 months when we've been running this webinar, typically I use a presentation to present, what is mentorship, et cetera, et cetera. But I think today we have, quite a bit of data with us. And I thought instead of just showing slides, I should invite people who have actually benefited from the program. So we reached out to a couple of people. Time was of the essence. We didn't have much time. And I'm so happy that the two people that I reached out, both of them, they said yes. And what I would like is that either you, Sushmaji, or Mansi, if you can just pin the video of Abhishek Kumbhat.
Yes.
Akriti Jain. And sure. I need to stop sharing, correct?
Yeah.
So I have stopped sharing.
Yeah, Abhishek is being spotlighted. Hi, Abhishek, and thank you.
Okay, so can we get both of them? Because
both of them? Sure. Yeah, we'll do that right away. Here. Thank you, Akriti, for volunteering.
Okay, so I will start with Abhishek. you know, elders go first, Abhishek.
I guess I could be better, but anyway, go for it.
No, I'll ask her questions first, but I will ask you first. So, you know, Abhishek and I, we just spoke a few days ago, and it just seemed as if we knew each other forever. He heads technology and innovation at Skillrock. He has done his master's and PhD from IIT Delhi. I can see a postdoctoral in the horizon. And then we have Akriti. Akriti works in the finance and analytics area with MX. She has a bachelor in engineering and she graduated in 2019. And she's based out of Guna, MP. There are two things that I always, you know, believed when it comes to coaching and mentoring. These things, I think the people who are in the urban areas, they have easy access to it. But I think India will really benefit when it goes to the hinterland. You know, when we talk about cricket, India became world beaters only when cricket went to hinterland. Similarly, the benefit of coaching and mentoring will be harnessed once it goes to the hinterland. And Akriti, she personifies that. So I'm going to first ask Akriti, okay? Akriti, please share with us. I know you did tell me when I was speaking with you yesterday, how is the JPF mentoring platform useful for someone with your background?
Akriti,
yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, now you are. Go ahead, please.
Okay, thank you. So when sir talks about my background, I come from a third tier city where also I'm the first person from both sides of my family who is stepping into a corporate world. Moreover that, being a female, is also a one factor which is there with my background history associated. So I always felt that I lack that area specific mentoring or training or a views or expertise that a person who might have access to all those things might have. So first and foremost, coming from this background was and going into a corporate world was a big step in itself. So JPF is like a use is a access to me to reach out to people who have already begun their journey and are succeeding that in that. So it has been such a fabulous journey for me. For last 4 months, I've been associated with JPF. The access that I have, and moreover that, back of your mind, you have this thing that, okay, if I have any questions, if I have face any personal problem, there are people who are taking out their time who can help me to answer my questions, to give me that clarity, and JPF is that platform for me over this. Been benefited a lot from it. It helped me growing as a person and as a professional at the same time.
So you gave me a couple of examples when I was speaking with you, I think it was last night. Can you just share that with the audience?
So when I typically had one session, if you say formal one session, but I don't consider it just as a one session because all the level up series, if you have, if you can connect the dots, you can definitely apply the concepts and the discussion which are there. So I would say I had multiple sessions with JPF in that sense. So it helped me bring that clarity to my mind. Back of your mind, you have that, you know that, okay, this is something, this is like the option that I have. But at times you don't want to face it because you know that this might be difficult. You know that, okay, you will face these problems. Okay, you don't want to, you have fear of speaking. You have a fear of reaching to people. So that clarity as a package, I can understand it and I can implement it. Through these sessions, I can talk to people, I can reach out to people, I can understand the tech. So I had questions regarding the career change. I have recently switched my company and I was confused about the tech stack that I was going to use, in what is the future of analytics and everything. So That has been a great session to build, like, for someone who has seen such a drastic change in that same industry. I would say that this platform has been such a enriching in itself. You interact with that, with people. So overall, the journey has been a really amazing one for me.
Okay. So, you know, in order to prepare for your session, I mean, there was one opportunity that you were going to take. You know, what did you do in order to prepare yourself so that you maximize the time with the mentor?
So I believe that since all the mentors have such a rich experience, they can help you with most of the things that a person like me, who is a young professional who is stepping into the corporate world. So probably they can help you with almost everything. But to bring the best out of that session, best out of that 30 minutes, you need to prepare yourself. So I noted down all the questions that I had. I prioritized which one are of the most important for me in terms of my short-term and middle-term goals. I made a flow out of it, okay, so that it helped me to understand and to maximize the gain, as well at the same time, it helped my mentor to understand what are the questions that I'm having in my mind, to articulate it in a such a format that it gives you a maximum output. So it is very important to realize that what is the journey flow that you want to take out of, and what are the things that you want to take out of this session. Second thing which is very important is to have an open mindset and to open up to the ideas. At times you might have some different perspective and you are getting a totally different 180 view perspective of it. So it is very important to be open-minded, and you have to go with that mindset into that session, which is very important, I think.
What have you started believing about yourself from this session, after this session?
So first and foremost, I was a very introvert person, to be frank. So from the session, from the Level Up series, one thing that I know, okay, there's nothing wrong in reaching out to people. You should do that. You should interact with people to listen to their views. So that has been a game changing. When I was asked about if I want to speak today, I was frightened till my core, but then I'm like, okay, opportunities does not come like a gift wrap to you. You have to identify the opportunities and have to take it. So that one thing that, okay, you can reach out to people. Communication is the key. I reached out to several mentors on LinkedIn to thank them, to interact with them apart from it. So that one very life-changing perspective, I would say, is GPF and this mentorship program helped me is in a form of communication, to reach out to people. That is one very big key takeaway. Apart from that, I have like tech stack and the analytics, and those are things there, but this is something which I can implement on a daily basis in my life.
Thank you so much, Akriti. You are one of the reasons why we keep doing this, and God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, JP.
Abhishek, over to you.
Jai Janain, sir.
Jai Janain, nice to see you. You know, you are a CTO with the company. Yeah, I remember you mentioned you have nearly 200 people in your team, and you must be mentoring and coaching them. So the question that I have for you is, you know, what made you consider mentoring for yourself?
Thank you, sir. So what I would say is that, as you rightly said, that over like 16, 17 years of experience, and more so during my education time as well, I've been always coaching and guiding cousins, college juniors, as well as youngsters for the office. And what I would, a new thought that came in is that because I was giving that, today God gave me the opportunity to have come to this group and ask with, right, that I need mentorship, right? So because it was a 16-year journey, right, into the career, I was very open to go to my seniors, friends, colleagues who have achieved a lot, and asking like what to do, what not to do. over a period of time that started reducing, right? And it started feeling that, yes, I am now giving back instead of taking it. 16 years happened. I thought, like, now it is a time that I need to challenge myself at this stage of time. If I don't question myself today, somebody else would come and question my existence. That was one very important thing. And one very good thought which was there in my mind, and Sanyogji, you gave it a very nice title in the form of a title of a book by saying that what got me here won't take me to the next stage, which was so enlightening that whatever the way I've been doing today, if I continue to do that, I would be here where I am, right? So I need to go to the next level. So that was, those were the two key things that were brought me to a stage that I need to go out and ask people, am I at the right path or not? Am I in the right journey? So that those are the two key reasons that I wanted to go to the next level.
So the other question that I have for you, did it help?
Yes, it did. Means to all the people to whom I connect to, means as a mentor, I reached out to three people into the JPF team. And whenever I sat with very open mind of okay, what can I ask? Like, what can I share from my side? Certainly, I always shared, like, what is my background? What am I at this stage of time? And then I asked various questions. The most important thing is that I didn't go to anybody with the typical transactional question. Achha, main ye hoon aur ye kar do. The most important thing is being curious and seeking for a new perspective. So the if I would sit in that session with listening a new perspective, I can always contextualize into my context per se. But the most important thing is getting the right perspective. One very interesting example or analogy I give to my friends is that most of the people who are around here and anybody who have thought for that I need some guidance are like a fast ball in a cricket. And the mentor is a batsman and a skilled batsman that needs just a small direction and then you touch the boundary. Then you score. That's a very interesting analogy, and I'll say that everybody must can consider that everybody of you are like fastball, right? Everybody of us is, right? High potential, high energy. Just take that direction, go and achieve it. One more thing which I would also say is that when I was actually coming to that mentorship session, and I would say those thoughts would be with a lot of other people as well, that couple of things that hinder us from approaching to somebody, right? One thought which I learned in very early stage of my thing is that LKK, log kya kahenge? Like, main to itna experienced aadmi hai, isko ye bhi nahi aata, phir ye kya kar raha hai, ye to farji hai, blah, 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 right? It makes you so vulnerable, right? Amit ji ne bataya itna kuch, Vishal ji ne bola ki main retreat mein gaya tha, log kya kahenge, achha, ye to dimaag mein kuch garbad hai, right? So think about it, that all of them have been vulnerable and expose themselves. So embrace your vulnerability. That's one thing. The second thing which at times comes is because if we are going to a person which is of a similar context, we feel ki yaar ye baat agar ghoom ke kahin mere jankar ke paas pahunch gayi to zyada takleef. That fear of confidentiality, right? So main isme kahunga ki all these senior people, all these mentors, jab aap ek bar khul ke jaoge na, to this would bring a lot of light to you. Right, a lot of enlightenment, and sab log, sorry, in a very lighter note, sab khaye khilaye hain, sab ne itna mentorship kiya hai, everybody knows that ki wo confidentiality bina bole aati hai, right? So when you openly go to them, they understand. Yaar, ye hui hai. Aur ek aur cheez jo main Sanyog ji se baat kar raha tha, maine discussion karte hue bol diya, maine kaha aap to bade bhai ke saman ho. So the kind of connect that came with him was so amazing. So these are the couple of things which I would say that go openly. I went openly with everybody. And sometimes Shubh was so quick. Aaj 11 baje ye banda available hai mentorship ke liye. I was like, just go and grab it. Right. And interestingly, during the discussion, it went so well ki aadha ghanta kya ek ghanta kahan gaya pata hi nahi chala. that was so flawless discussion that happened. So ultimately, it gave me a very, very new perspectives to myself and the kind of situations I was.
Thank you, both of you. And I think you have said it much better than all the presentations that I've been making for the last 4 months. So I really appreciate it. And you are the best ambassadors for the program. Sushmaji, the common theme is, like Lord Buddha said, you know, when the student is ready, the teacher will come. So let me just share a couple of more slides, and then I will hand over the session back to you. So the program is evolving. More mentors are being empaneled. We launched Sambad. That was on November 21st. That was the first time when I met Abhishek, and you know, we got so much input from the group that we are incorporating that. One of the things that the group really told us is that, you know, you have got such great mentors, but how do we maximize, you know, what kind of questions that we should be asking? So and so we have launched several initiatives. You know, group mentoring sessions have been launched on several topics, multiple sessions with the same mentor being considered, standalone sessions on specific topics such as leadership are in the planning stage. As a matter of fact, the dates are already announced. Himanshuji, Prashantji, and others, they have agreed to run those sessions. Going further, these are three group mentoring sessions which are available. On strategic communication for professional success, Jyotiji is running that. How to ace interviews, Vishalji is running that. Developing career as a woman, how to break the glass ceiling for aspiring women leaders, Monica ji is running that. Standalone sessions by Prashantji and Himanshu ji on leadership, they're all on. If you're interested, there is email address where you can, you know, write your interest. By the way, I think Shubh must have already posted those on the chat. How to join, this information is also being posted in the chat. It is available over here. And you can just take a quick picture of it, or you can just copy it from the chat, the message will be there. And with that, I'm going to give it back to you, Sushmaji, to continue the beautiful conversation that you have, you know, been having with our three guests. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much. You know, it's so heartening and to hear all these stories. You know, मुझे लगता है कि अरे clock मेरी 40 साल पहले चल जाती है, and I could be part of this mentorship program and learn and do my whole journey. हम तो ठोक ठाक के सीखे.
I'm with you.
Now, I'd like to, with permission of everyone, you know, and have uninterrupted conversations with our panelists, which we would like to do. I would just say, because instead of, we've got 8 minutes to 12:30, and I know we are very particular about time. So we'll just invite Nipunji to share a formal vote of thanks, right? And after that, we can just keep it open for informal discussions with the panelists. I'm sure that would be perfectly fine. So Nipunji, could we just have a formal vote of thanks?
Thank you, Sushmaji. Jai Jinen to everyone. I first of all, thanks to all my participants who have joined this fifth Level Up series that we are conducting on every month. Thank you very much, all participants. And there are these series which are being run. These are being run by JPM mentors who are also otherwise available to Jain community members on one-to-one basis. I encourage everyone to join this forum of mentorship and take the benefit of all, which is being run by all of our mentors. And Sanyog ji has just shared all the data, which is very exciting. And BPF core team, heartily thankful to all these mentors who have taken out time from their busy schedule, and particularly on Sunday morning, which is very personal to them. So thank you to all of our mentors. And I also thank the JPF core team who has taken out such a wonderful session today, like spiritual intelligence. In our normal day-to-day thought process, we actually miss this particular topic, which is really, really important to everyone at all levels of management. And it's a really wonderful choice. I personally enjoyed this a lot, and very thanks to choose this out, and very nice topic. And this topic has given me so much, and Amit ji has particularly very like he has given a takeaway, which is very important, that meet yourself once a day at least, which we hear many times but always forget. But this is a really very good takeaway for the session today. And very unfortunately, it is not happening, but we really hope to see you offline as well to all the participants. Thank you very much. Jai Jinendra.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And you know, it's been a wonderful session. And I know that people who've attended today have only one thing. Dil mange more. Right? Even in the chat box, Amol Jain wrote, we need to have part two. When are you organizing part two? So back to the panelists, and thank you, everybody. We'll just stop the recording, and I think we'll just open it up for discussion